see it? Green flare coming from Mars. It's getting closer. What's going on? Can anybody hear me? Come in. Come in.
Adaptions can be very touchy little critters, can't they? No one's ever satisfied with the end product, and those who are often relegated by the gatekeepers as idiots who don't know any better. And whilst I'm one idiot that can appreciate a good adaption now and again, as well as why such things are required in the transfer of medium to medium, I can also understand the frustration behind adaptions being nothing like the books we read. But here's a hint. If the book was that good in the first place, then use your imagination and read the book again. However, I can also relate as to how frustrating faithful-to-page adaptions can be. Manga to anime, for example, can be exceedingly frustrating for me, especially when I already know how the story is going to end. Helsing Ultimate notwithstanding, anything too faithful to the source material can present needless repetition that the odd twist in an adaption can otherwise alleviate. It's for this reason that as much as I love the faithful adaptation of Helsing Ultimate, it's the original Helsing anime series that holds a special place in my heart, largely due to its rather unique and different ending. War of the Worlds has been a victim of a similar set of crimes, from adaptions to faithful rendition to downright bastardization, and not one of them are perfect. In fact, the closest we ever got to a truly faithful rendition of the novel to film was thanks to a small film company called Pendragon, and for all its efforts and a rather attempt at self-trumpet blowing suggesting that its lead actor Anthony Piena could become the next Keanu Reeves, the other War of the Worlds out there, out of the three that tried to cash in on the Spielberg masterpiece, was actually the one to fall more flat on its face. And that's pretty upsetting when you take into consideration that the film that was meant to be 100% pitch faithful to the novel was actually worse than the Asylum film production, which by many fans of the novel still think was better than the Paramount release.
Well, at least it's a million to one against.
Yeah. A good Asylum movie. Fancy that. Probably explains why it's so hard to find on DVD these days. Can't have a great movie tarnishing the bad reputation of Asylum film cash-ins now, can we? The problem with novels like The War of the Worlds and, I dare say, Bram Stoker's Dracula, which is just as much a victim of this problem, is that whilst the novels themselves were, and still are to some extent, groundbreaking, and this is where I traverse into the blasphemous, being a fan of both novels themselves, both Dracula and The War of the Worlds are, well, not to put too fine a point on it, pretty long and boring books to get through. And whilst the Pendragon film was a brave and albeit flawed attempt at a perfect book-to-film interpretation, the weaknesses of the novel as it stands today in the 21st century are glaringly obvious and don't translate that well to film. True, when seen alongside War of the Worlds, The True Story, the second attempt at the War of the Worlds mythos by Pendragon Films, the better version is pretty obvious. The adaptation was way more interesting than the version that was closest to the novel itself. Jeff Wayne's better known musical is by far more breathtaking and atmospheric, and that in itself is not a perfect book to musical adaptation of the novel itself. It's pretty close. But not everyone I met who listened to the musical are even aware that the narrator had a brother in London telling his side of events, or that even the curate is not ever called Parson or even by name in the novel, much less known or commented upon having ever been married. At the end of the day, adaptions are not telling the story, but telling an interpretation of the story, in that in some cases translate better to its audience that it is intended for rather than the actual source material. And let's be honest now, how many of us in the real world have actually read the complete Lord of the Rings trilogy? I'm sure there are a brave few souls out there like myself, but I have to be honest with you, the only reason I managed to finish it at all was because modern fantasy trope was a part of my original thesis that got me graduated. In short, I was forced to read in intricate detail the construct of a flower in 20 pages on Frodo's journey before he even reached the border of the Shire. It makes me thankful that I was able to enjoy a compelling story and film at all. Well, there is no way I could truly appreciate the scope of Tolkien's world building.
Is it secret? Is it safe?
This is the One Ring, forged by the Dark Lord Sauron. Sauron needs only this ring to cover all the lands of a second darkness. He's seeking it. Seeking it all. His thought is bent on it.
No one knows it's here, do they? Do they, Gandalf?
And this is the major issue with adapting this novel. Anyone telling you that the original novel of the War of the Worlds is in any way exciting is, well, not to put too fine a point on it, lying. I'm not putting it down because it is a well-written piece of visceral horror. It is very descriptive in its carnage of the human race, and a very gripping read if what you're looking for is a horror story much better written than Dracula. But despite what certain adaptations would tell you, the book is not an exciting read, and it was never meant to be. What a lot of people who are fans of the faithful adaption tend to forget is that The War of the Worlds is not a mere science fiction story. It's a disaster story, in which the science fiction elements, whilst amazing in scope, pales to insignificance to the impact the invasion itself has on the central seat of power, as well as the individuals that are the products of an empire once considered impossible to fail. The fact that the perspective is from the point of view of the narrator only adds to the sense of doom that the book delivers. It reveals very little about the Martians, save for their motivations, leaving much of the machinations to the imaginations of the reader themselves, such as the use of flying machines that the Martians used to spread the black smoke in much longer distances. Which the narrator admits, if used more often in the war, the Martians, whilst facing the same inevitable end, would have made shorter work of their conquest. That they didn't use them, whether by choice or design, is left to us, the reader, to fill in the gap with theory and supposition. Indeed, the very death of the Martians and why is left unknown to the narrator until the very epilogue of the novel. Up until then, it's not even suggested that the Martians could have died of the common cold. Their dying machines are just another mystery left to discern by whatever secrets the dead invaders could tell with their rotten corpses. So when I read complaints about how bad an adaptation the BBC series was, I must admit to being at a bit of a loss. As I said before, the point of an adaptation is not to be word for word accurate, because as I said before, the novel is a bit of a slog to get through. But retold in a way that a new and younger audience can relate to without losing the essence of the novel itself. And in that, save for a few misgivings that I have, the BBC version of The War of the Worlds provides a reasonably good adaptation that even the musical doesn't touch on. And I've got to admit, I for one am pretty pleased that I no longer have to put up with just Jeff Wayne's tripods dominating my Facebook feed again. So let's discuss the so-called BBC adaptation, its positives, its negatives, and what actually caused the ire of the fans of the novel, and indeed, if they are deserved. Before we start, let's be clear. War of the Worlds is a survivor's tale. It's told from the point of view of the survivor, and everything that they know and understand, we know and understand. Perhaps one of the biggest gripes in the books that I have seen is how little the Martians were explained in the series. And if I have to be frank, whilst I can understand that to a certain degree, if it's motivation you're looking for, go for Independence Day. At least there, the aliens talk to us and recognize us as an almost intellectual equal. Here, in the series, there is nothing to understand about the invaders' motivations, tactics, or even endgame. Theories could be very abound if you put your mind to it. And yes, there will be spoilers here, such as my theory on who the actual intelligence behind the invasion actually was. The pilots of the tripod war machines who ended up dying pretty quickly? Or the iconic red vegetation and crystals that eventually conquered the landscape in the aftermath of this particular incarnation of the war? The Martians themselves didn't seem very engaging as a life form when they came out of the machines in this. In fact, one meme on a Facebook group asks, "How the hell did they build their machines?" Good question. But I put it to you, do these things look like they were constructed to you? No. In fact, I would argue they look almost like something we already see in nature. If you actually take a closer look at the events in the series, nearly everything about the invaders is an ecosystem in malevolent calculation. On observation, it's amazing how the Martians mimic us with their invasion methods. From the very offset of their arrival, their first dealings with us are a mass of human beings digging their artifact up from the rubble, flashing them with rays of invisible light to catch the human image on film. In the same way we gather data on them, they too reflect our means of doing so on us, and use such methods against us. It's almost like a dark mirror, the orb grabbing our image, and the Martians themselves using an invisible ray of light to wipe us out. Could it be that they originally came not so much in peaceful means, but in the same way of a natural advance to another land as birds would fly south for the winter, only to interpret our rays of light as weapons against them? Was their original malevolent intent towards our world twisted to malevolence as a result of a misunderstanding of our intent towards them? Like a cornered animal surrounded by a pack of wolves, were they more scared of us than we were of them? And as we bared our teeth with spades and camera flashes, they too bared theirs back at us. Only their teeth were sharper. Everything about the invaders screams symbiosis. They are, ironically, a force of nature, representative of the cruelty of colonization and the indifference to the local population they encounter. The story is told from two perspectives, both in character and in construction. First of all, we have not one, but two protagonists separated from each other by the war, yet so ironically brought closer together through another conflict, that of society and judgment. Pariahs in their own right, due to an extramarital affair, the star-crossed lovers are embroiled in their own conflicts with extended family, their neighbours, and their workplace. Whilst it's easy to sympathise with their stress and to look upon the brother and his family as the bigots, I can't help but feel a twinge of naivety and selfishness on part of the protagonists. True, their love is what gives them meaning, but I could not help but feel that George, the male protagonist, was so sheltered by his upbringing he feels he deserves so much better than the treatment he should have expected in a judgmental era. Amy is also pretty selfish in that regard, almost to the point of expecting George's family to accept them and their situation. Oh, she comes off as sympathetic to George's plight, but in no part in the series do you sense that she's risking or sacrificing anything to make it easier on him. I'm pretty sure they're living off the meagre earnings of Amy's estate, because George's brother makes it clear that they're going to cut him off. But there is more pain portrayed in Frederick and his ultimatum to George than there is really in George's and Amy's plight.
George has been my brother for 36 years. When he was born, my mother allowed me to carry him in to meet her father. And I looked after him on his first day of school. He was scared, and he'd forgotten his pocket handkerchief, and he was crying for it, and I gave him mine. He was my baby brother. My baby brother. And that was that. Until you came along.
I'm going to have his child.
I'm not saying that George's family are in the wrong. George's marriage was pointless and as barren as the Martian's dying world, but their portrayal of his wife made him more of a monster than a victim of the era's backward thinking. Now, I understand this was a large-scale project to film, and there is only so much you can throw into the story in 3 episodes. But if you can't give the situation more gravitas or even drama, then it's probably best left out so you can focus on the A-plot. The protagonists being the victims of a backward mindset of the time doesn't add to their plight in the war. It's just there for the sake of giving something for the audience to sympathise with no overall payoff in the conclusion. Oh, they had a child out of wedlock. And yet I have to ask, how is this any different from any other child who lost their parents during the war? Is this some subtext telling us that in the end all of us are the same, and that even the great and powerful can be dragged down to the same level as pariahs and beggars? Ooh, hidden subtext that really in the end wasn't needed. Oh, did I happen to mention that I actually love this series, by the way? The story's real strength comes in its overall presentation, both during and after the invasion. We see the two stories crashing together to their inevitable conclusion, and it's very clever when you approach it from this perspective. In the novel, we see great expansion of knowledge thanks to the aftermath of the invasion, whereas in the series, we see no clear answers in the aftermath, only more questions and more tragedy. We as the audience already know what happened to the Martians because we've seen this trope so many times before. Yet the survivors, save for the army and the government, are kept in the dark. It's the army who take credit for the Martian defeat in the aftermath, though they fared no better than anyone else. And it's so brutal to see the remnants of the British Empire brought down to little more than a third world country with barely enough resources to sustain itself. The world has clearly abandoned the greatest nation in the world, or itself has suffered a similar fate. Whatever the case, like the suffering we see in the world about us today, there is no help, no respite, no hope. And the truth is as much a victim of the aftermath as we see books and posters praising the heroic defeat of the Martians at the hands of the mighty British military. The greatest lie to keep control of a desperate population, only emphasized by the fact that crops only grow on hallowed ground of the church. A sign that God has indeed given hope to the hopeless. That society has fallen so much in order to survive is unsurprising. That the government would dare to keep the truth from the population should not be that surprising to you either. Throughout the series, it is drilled into us that the British see themselves as the superior race. As the preacher points out in the aftermath, how much uproar would erupt if the truth of the Martians' defeat actually did come out, even if it would save lives in the end?
It's proof of nothing. It's hardly anything.
Take it or leave it, sir. It's dying.
And the victory, the knowledge of victory, the knowledge that God and Great Britain repelled the creatures, you would take that away and have the men think instead that it was their own rot that was humanity's salvation.
I think it's more suggestive of a higher purpose, that the Martians were killed by the smallest creatures that God put on the planet, that we have learned to fight off or live with over millions of years at the cost of millions of lives.
That's not Christianity, sir, that's Darwinism.
All survival is built on sacrifice, and that is a fact.
It's such a shame that the aftermath story is so bloody good, as it makes the invasion seem like little more than a mere setup for the actual story. The stronger moments come in the aftermath story, whereas the weaker moments come in the invasion story, which, whilst powerful, have little impact save for the few scenes that underline the utter hopelessness of the situation. Now, if any of you watched Star Trek Discovery Season 2, you might understand my frustration with such an approach. There is an episode where 25 whole minutes is spent on the setup teaser before the actual titles kick in. And that's not only pointless, it's frustrating as hell. The invasion comes across as like that. It's as if it's just a throwaway teaser for the actual story in two long episodes. And really, it's poor setup at that. Let me give you an example of such a poor setup. There is a scene where George and an old lady he befriends in the Exodus drink from a water fountain, and then the camera focuses in on the tap with ominous music. Yeah, that's all very good and all, but that's about it. Now imagine how powerful that same scene could have been if previously we see, as we did in the Spielberg movie, a river filled with bodies streaming down the Thames. The ominous music then fills up as the camera pulls away from the river to the dripping tap. The clue in what's going to happen is in the build-up here. Simply saying, "Oh, there's something wrong with the water," with some ominous music is akin to telling the audience something rather than showing it. It's lazy musical and visual exposition. The marching fighting machines, though, are terrifying to behold. Alien in their construction and their approach, combined with the awesome impact of the black smoke, a concept hardly used in other adaptions, as the most effective means of extermination and spreading the red weed. They have fast become my favourite renditions of a Wells vision of an organic fighting machine to date. And the Martians themselves? I have no idea where to begin here. As I pointed out before, these disappointments are probably the least dangerous creatures about the invasion. In fact, on deeper reflection, I can't imagine how these things are able to construct anything, and their behaviour is more animal-like, rather than showing any intellectual capacity at all. It's why I resigned myself to thinking that these creatures were only a means to an end for a rather different invasion in this adaptation. The one that actually succeeded in the aftermath story. It's the only way I can justify their existence at all, in that the weed, or even the alien crystal itself, was the driving intelligence behind the invasion, and that these creatures were but another tool, or perhaps a victim of a similar invasion themselves. Much like the aliens in the Great Martian War were slaves to the metal itself, were these poor CGI monstrosities victims of the flora that dominated their world in a similar way?
What if this is what they wanted? Send down machines? To start the process of making Earth again, in the image of Mars. That's what the black smoke did. That's what it was for. Whatever it left behind has spread across the Earth like a virus, growing first into the red weed, and then into the shards we see emerging from the ground. Harvests fail. The water's getting redder. Babies aren't born. Unless we can think of some way to stop this, this will not be our planet anymore.
Not that any of that excuses their disappointing existence in the story at all. I understand we needed something organic to show their slowing decay in health to clue us in as to how eventually they died out. But really, Wells narrated that one could scarcely imagine the horror of seeing an actual Martian. And yet, since Spielberg and his cute tripodic ETs made us laugh out loud, it's really sad to see the globulous Martians relegated to a bastardization of a tripodic creature that wasn't good to begin with, and only made much worse here. All that being said, I still love this adaption. It has tremendous flaws that the positives could have overshadowed if only they had more time to gel the two elements of the story together. Three episodes, I fear, was hardly enough to convey the actual story they were trying to tell. Instead, we had a rushed script with great ideas and potential, wasted cinematic opportunities, and poor character development that deserved better examination. It seems they were so keen on getting to the invasion as soon as possible that they forewent something more foreboding, like the slow burn, which a series of this potential desperately needed, and instead rushed us into something that on paper is actually a wonderful idea with great production potential, but in practice too big for both the budget and the time they were given to make it. And it was already delayed by a year, with promises to release the series as early as last Christmas in 2018. If I have to be honest, the loyalist in me is fine with this adaption. I would have been much finer with a six-parter, focusing on the characters behind it and the world building. I would have been much happier if the invasion wasn't so rushed into. Perhaps the first two episodes with the foreboding build-up, with the following two focusing on the initial invasion and the last two on the aftermath. But would anyone have watched it? The pessimist in me says no. As I said earlier, many commenters said that they wanted more excitement and explosions, and the slow burn would have had trouble delivering that. I guess I'm old school, but I do miss the old storytelling of a Doctor Who episode where so little happens but for the build-up to the actual reveal of an old enemy that no one expected. Like the Cybermen in the Earthshock, for example. But we live in a get-to-the-point age, in which sadly a story like this, with so much subtlety in its initial construction, couldn't possibly deliver in just three episodes. And whilst I love this story, I can understand why a lot of people don't like it. No, it wasn't word for word faithful to the source material, and that to me was one of its strongest suits, as well as its stunning musical score by Russ Davis. God, that music is so enrapturing and ethereal, and as blasphemous as this may come across to many of you, it's so much better to my ears than the Jeff Wayne musical. With Russ Davis's score, the visual effects, and the actors who all carry a sadly flawed production through, I can't fault any of their contribution. If anything, they are the very people and moments that help carry this production to a level that I actually enjoy. And yes, you can have an awesome soundtrack, visual effects, and the best acting in the world in a pretty badly scripted film, which this adaptation of War of the Worlds has in spades. But as daring with the source material as the production and writing team tried to be, it failed to deliver something that they clearly needed more time for. You know, that thing that the writers of Game of Thrones were offered for season 8 but turned down. You can't rush a masterpiece, which is what this miniseries could have been without sacrificing the obvious potential we had behind it. Which is such a shame. Because otherwise, as I said before, I did actually enjoy this miniseries.